I don't want to do this.
One, and we're live. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Invictus community stream. Right now, we have with us, we're starting our Dungeon World Community Game 2, Session 0. And we've got with us Oscar. Hello, Oscar.
Hi.
We've got Michael. Hello, Michael. Freezy, Freezy.
Hello.
And then we've got Juan.
There he is.
And then we have our wonderful GM, Jeff. And we've missing Marcus right now, but we'll see if we can get him on shortly. So what I'd like to do is go through an introduction. You know, definitely acknowledge the Invictus guys for being our gracious hosts and allowing us to be here with everybody. And we just really appreciate the opportunity to be able to watch the shows, but also even the community makes it so awesome for us to be able to be involved and in their games and be able to spend our XP and do a lot of cool things there, but also enjoy each other, and that's really, really, you know, the big point. We'd also like to invite everybody else that wants to come. We'd love for you guys to join us. But for now, we're going to go ahead and get started with our session zero. Jeff, I'll hand it off to you.
Oh boy. Well, it's great to be here, guys. I'm certainly excited, and I definitely have been hopefully infecting the rest of the group with this level of excitement by getting them involved with character creation and that sort of thing. So
I think we've been motivating you more than you've been motivating us, to be honest.
I can't argue with that. I mean, just the idea of all of the different connections and bonds and the character development and everything, I'm hanging out in three-point land, and I'm just tossing up the balls and see if they fall in the net. Mm-hmm. And you guys have just been like taking those seeds and you've been running with them, so it's really just awesome to see that. So my tip of the hat to y'all for everything that you're doing. It's definitely making it exciting for me, that's for sure. So we're going to be looking at setting up our characters. We've spent some time already going through the character creation process, and let's see here. I'm going to take a look at a couple of things here. Open up my chat window so that I have, let's see here. Ah, there we go. All right, there we go. Technology is a wonderful thing, folks. Never let it be said that it's difficult what these guys do every week. I do not know how they accomplish this, because on my side, whenever I do any kind of recordings, I record them, edit them, and then take out all of the nonsense and tomfoolery that I tend to add to the game, and then let things rip as they go. So, in any case, character creation. We're playing Dungeon World, and first and foremost, the thing to understand about Dungeon World is that it is a whole mess of narrative control for everybody. It's not just the Dungeon Master that's going to be in charge of running the game, but what's kind of neat is the control that you have of contributing to the story. So we're all kind of in charge of making the story work. So if you've seen my intro video, I won't bore you with too many of the gory details. If you haven't seen it, go and look at it. I'm always happy to throw my ugly mug onto the internet, I guess. In any case, thanks all for being here. Thanks all for joining up. Really do appreciate it. So let's get started. Let's just kind of go around the horn a little bit and talk about each of our characters, just to kind of get a feel for the type of person that we're playing, what we've brought to the table so far. And we can just do kind of a brief overview, and then we can talk about how we get together, how our bonds are going to work in the game. And then we'll spend some time to kind of develop the world that we're going to start into. It seems like a lot of work for a one-shot, and I'll agree, yes, it is. But this is also kind of for the community to understand what Dungeon World is like. I'll give you one brief little thing here, and that is normally when I play Dungeon World, I have about 15 minutes of prep, and that's as the Dungeon Master. Because I'll go in, and if I have some maps or something I want to do, maybe that might extend it another half hour or something, but I come to the table with a narrative thread that I want to run, And then we all sit around the table and create characters and how we fit in to that thread together. And it's especially helpful for a one-shot. You'll probably see Dungeon World or Apocalypse World at your conventions, that sort of thing, because it's really geared towards a one-shot. However, we can have a lot of fun with a long-term campaign as well, so don't count Dungeon World out from that aspect as well. But yeah, for the community stream, we wanted to do a little pre-game prep, and that's exactly what this episode is, and that's exactly what we've been doing over the last couple weeks. So here we go. Right. So show of hands, who wants to start first, or should I just go ahead and assign people?
I volunteer, Oscar.
Ah! Already passing it along. All right,
hey, Jeff,
Oscar.
Now may be a good time to see if you can transfer the controls over to you. Are you able to select on anybody else? That may just be the actual control room that actually shares.
Let's see here. I am going to go over to control room. I can go to the control room and I can maneuver things around.
But as far as like the actual, so the little windows at the bottom where everybody's video feed is, you can't click on one and select one of them.
I can go to one of their windows and select them. Yeah, so I can change what's being presented on the screen for me. Yeah.
On your screen? Okay, cool. Right. Well, that's actually kind of not what I wanted though.
But so I'm changing it right now, and you're not seeing the change on your.
Correct. So, okay. So what I'll do is I'll kind of leave it open like that. So we're just kind of getting a feel for what it's going to be like with me kind of dropping out maybe, and now it's kind of I've selected off of Jeff, and now it's voice activated. So.
All
right. Juan, you can go ahead, and it should jump right to you.
Okay. Yes. Hello. Testing. You want me to go? Okay, I'll just go first then in that case. So I am playing a dwarf named Jutmerlum the Subduer. He's an ex-diplomat for the Palestone clan who was betrayed really harshly by his thane to the point where he was framed for the murder of his family. And On that night, he decided, you know what, I'm not going to deal with this anymore. So he escaped his prison, and for the amount of time that, from that point on to where we are today, he has been working as, basically in the protective services, as a bodyguard for other people. And he's heard about the rumors that the Pale Clan has been basically dismantled, and from this troop, which happens to be the troop that Ashley Wick is, which you'll be hearing about later. So in order for him to make it back to the Palestone clan to see what was left of it and to see and to ensure that nothing, that history doesn't repeat itself, he goes with Ashley towards this expedition to the Palestone clan to see what can be arranged and how can he help.
Nice.
That's my character. Yeah.
That's a great start. All right. Let's see here. You want to go with Michael? You want to try and give it a go?
You mean my character background?
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about who you're playing.
Okay. I'm playing Ashley Wick. She's an immolator. And yeah, she's been traveling with like a traveling circus group or performance troupe, and but she never really truly understood her power until she felt it start to get weaker. Then you know it's been so much a part of her personality of her that she felt that if she loses this power, then she doesn't know who she is. So, a gypsy in her performance troupe told her that it was a bard. A bard told her about this clan of dwarves that had access to this a library that may contain her the answers that she seeks. So, and that's where she also meets up with Jutmerlum. And then they head over to for their expedition. Yeah.
Cool. Excellent.
Sorry, I have a little bit of stage fright right now.
Oh no! Don't worry about it. It's
welcome
okay.
to the club.
Yeah, it's it's natural. Don't worry.
Yeah, you're totally cool. So if you guys, and I know that, you know, I seem to have fog brain whenever I played Vampire the Requiem, so it was hard for me to think and kind of just kind of get used to the game itself. So but yeah, totally don't feel real nervous about playing. Just try to, you know, interact with the guys. Jeff's really good at doing what he does for a GM. He's been doing this for a little while, and then everybody else here, it, you know, is here to support everybody. So you're gonna feel a little bit nervous, but also too, this is a really cool time to play. So, you know, if you don't feel like acting or role playing necessarily, totally like jump out and explain kind of your character if that's a little bit more comfortable. So main goal is to just have fun. Make sure everybody's having fun, and then it doesn't really matter, you know, kind of how you play. We'd love to get all kinds of people playing. So so Michael, you know, don't worry about it, but you know, we understand. So
all right.
Marcus is here. Marcus is
yeah.
alive.
Marcus, you don't have a video feed, and I'm not sure if I hear anything.
No, neither.
Only silence.
He's working on it here.
Cool. All right, so I guess go ahead and go to Oscar.
Yeah.
I'm playing a dwarf. His name is Brynjar Oakenshield, and he's a fighter. And for the most part of his life, he's lived at the Palestone clan, and then a few years into his adulthood, his father died and left his heritage and his work over to his son, which was to be an executor for the clan's thane. Mm. And he basically became the black sheep of the entire clan. Nobody liked him except the thane, who always paid him for doing the work and following the law. But as I wrote in my character sheet, that just following the law turned into corruption and accusations that were not true, into just executing innocent bystanders because they were opposing the thane, who was getting more and more corrupt, which then led to the downfall of the entire clan. And with the clan nearly destroyed, he didn't knew what to do with himself, except trying to reclaim some sort of glory and restore the honor of the clan, even with his dark background. So he will do his best to redeem himself, perhaps get his conscience back and a place in life.
I like it.
Yeah, that's basically it, I think.
I like it. That's fantastic. I totally dig it. I gotta hand it to you guys. You guys are coming up with some really great backstory, especially, like I said, we're doing a one-shot. So, quite amazing. You guys are doing a fantastic job. All right, so I'm hoping Marcus is available. Is he, let's see here.
I do hope I wasn't the one executing him.
You better not, man. It's just now started.
I'm just following the law.
That's right.
And now, okay, we have two Marcuses there for a moment.
Oh.
He left. He's probably having internet issues, so that will happen. So you'll actually do like one and get stuck on there. So I may punt one of them here in just a second. So.
All right, we'll see what happens. Okay, well, let's try one thing here. I want to see about screen sharing to make sure that that's functioning okay for you guys. So let's give it a go here. Share this one, and let's see. Are you guys seeing the
screen share? We see ourselves seeing you seeing ourselves.
Oh well, that's just no good. Let's try that.
Greenception.
multiple perceptions. I don't like it. Okay. All right. Negative. We'll try that again. Come on, technology. You can do it.
I mean, it is true, but it showed the ghoul hangouts.
Hey.
There we go.
Booyah. All right, excellent. So just for the home crowd, as we're taking a look at some of the things that are part and parcel of the character sheet, a couple of the things that are interesting here with Dungeon World, and I went through in the intro, are taking a look at some of the items like look, which is basically what your character looks like, the kinds of things that mark you or make you unique. There was one thing that I think, and I'll make sure I'm going to start trying to call you guys by your character names. So Brynjar, is that how you pronounce it? I want to make sure that's right.
Yeah, Brynjar.
Brynjar, all right, perfect. So just taking a look at that one, and maybe it might help if I blow it up a little bit here. So the look that you have for yours, and again, you are an executioner, an headsman who has left the clan seeking honor once again. And the look that you have here for your dwarf, you have built. Your eyes are dead. So let's talk a little bit about that. So you're indicating that your eyes are feeling a little bit dead. Is that because of some of the things you've done?
Yeah, it affects his soul and how many bad things he's done to his life.
Okay.
All right. Hearing all the screams of those dying under his axe.
Right. Cool. So that's kind of giving you like a haunted aspect, you know, just that feeling of death that's in your background and hopefully not going to be in your future. Cool. I like it. And then there is the hair is shorn, and I know that you sent me a picture of your character, and we'll work on getting some overlays for folks so they can kind of get a glimpse of what they look like. But you had scars that were set along your face that you'd said that you had earned in a certain way. You recall what you'd sent to me?
Yeah, it's no secret. It was one person he didn't want to execute, and the Thane severely punished him for that.
Right. So you actually had received reprimand in a most extreme physical form from the Thane. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So let's see here. Let's jump over to Jutmerloon. Is that how, am I saying that right?
Jutmerloon.
Perfect. Alright, so I want to make sure that I'm getting all of the look here correct. So I have Mighty Thews. What is that reference? Mighty
Basically, Thews. He's built. He's very heavy set in terms of his muscular mass compared to everything else. Right. That's what Mighty Thews are. I had to look that up as well, so don't worry about it.
No worries. I wanted to make sure that the people at home understood what that meant. As I was displaying it to the screen, I was like, okay, we might want to go over that a little bit. And then due to spacing, I see that your eyes are haunted, not Han or Han Solo or whatever. It's just haunted. So what's given you that aspect?
What gave me that effect was the fact that everything that... By the way, I didn't even mention that my character is a barbarian. And the reason why he was an ex-diplomat was because, again, he did all that he can to save the clan from, like, the corrupt ways of the Thane, but it all led to naught. And just the traumatization of his clan betraying him, his family being slaughtered, and just basically being sentenced to death from the people he actually tried to save, it just left him at an emotional state that he can't deal with the fact that his clan did all this to him. While he was trying to do positivity towards it.
Right. I mean, it seems like in terms of game construction, when we're looking at things like, you know, Dungeons and Dragons, or we're looking at Pathfinder, and you think of the traditional barbarian, a lot of times you're thinking of the Conans, you're thinking of the ones that kind of grew up in a rural setting, and that kind of life, that basic life, hunter-gatherer life, has kind of led them towards a certain passionate existence, we'll call it, an exuberance for life, we'll say, but usually at the end of an axe. But the difference here, the little twist that they have for the barbarian in Dungeon World is interesting in that it's one of the core parts of the character class is being an outsider, and I think what's really interesting of what you've done here, Jutmerloon, is that you have gone from being a diplomat, a extreme insider to the outsider.
Yeah.
And I think that brings quite a bit of depth to your character. I like that a lot. So was there kind of like a point in time where you crossed that line, where you know, was it at the betrayal? Was it something that happened when you were already exiled?
It was the point of his execution. He was, as I explained in the sheet, what happened was that at the moment where the guards were going to bring him out to his execution, he decided, I'm not going to have this, and he basically fought his way out from the castle that from his prison cell to the outside. So just again, that's what makes it, that gave him the title the Irascible. That means he reacts to anger.
Right.
And just that anger fueled him to the point where he slaughtered most of the Thane's guards in order for him to escape and to just be in exile.
Right. Now, this might be an opportunity to talk a little bit about a bond. I noticed that you have one set of bonds that are there, but was there any involvement with Brynjar's character, or was Brynjar already gone by the time of your execution? Or your
as schedule? Far as I am aware, I didn't even know the existence of Brynjar.
Okay. All right.
So it was once we go into the bonds, it was very interesting to see what he meant, what he actually played in my escape.
Right, because we may think, and you know, obviously, Brynjar, I'll bring you in on this. What we may want to think about is, as a headsman, did you have like the traditional hood that was over? Was there a special helm or something that blocked your face?
Yeah, I think it was a hood, a dark hood, a black hood. So nobody would recognize him, except everybody knew his last name.
Right. Well, so you don't know which generation or which sibling or something.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay, that's cool, because what we can say is that, and again, it has to be kind of an agreement between the two of you, and we'll drift a little bit into bonds here briefly. So it has to be kind of an agreement between the two of you on the surface that, yeah, you know, as player characters, I can agree that, yeah, Brynjar was there, but I didn't know of his existence at that time because of the ceremony of having the hood.
Mm-hmm.
Now, would it be possible, and again, we can deepen the bond, would it be possible that Brynjar might have helped facilitate the escape? Maybe this was the point where Brynjar was really at the point of probably deciding to leave.
Are you asking both of us?
Potentially helping him escape, yeah, as a possibility. You know, maybe it was one of the guards you might have tripped up or something, you know, just short of killing anybody, you know,
Yeah, because there was at one point where I was trying to make the Slaughterfest was due to the fact that I was trying to make it to the Thane. And if anything, as I was escaping from the Thane's bedchambers, I could have just passed over one of the guards just to knock him over instead of just going out for the slaughter and just trying to look for the escape. Right. So that could have been Brynjar, if anything.
Nice. All right. Alright, I'm just making some notes here, as I want to do. Nice. Okay. Alright. So, and again, I'm going to start again using the character names, so Ashley, we'll move over to you if you're ready to go, and take a look at your character a little bit here. Let me switch over character sheets here. So you're an immolator, and this particular character class is owed towards sacrifice, and it's not, you know, in a traditional sense of sacrifice. It's actually things that are important to you. You're willing to give up in order to facilitate the power that you have as an immolator. So is there something that maybe you wanted to kind of talk about, like maybe one of the big things that you sacrificed, and then what did you gain from that? What kind of power or what kind of ability did you gain? And you can draw from one of your starting moves, that sort of thing, or whatever you would like to do.
Okay. Basically, the biggest thing that she sacrificed was a pocket watch that belonged to her father. Mm. And she used it to kind of like give her that ability of burning brand age and all that. So they figured that, okay, it'll be nice, or it'll be cool for the audience to see her like fight with a on stage with like a flaming rapier or something.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I like that. I like that a lot.
Well, like fire stuff.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. That's really
as
good.
As well as
All right. So, anything else that you want to throw in there? I didn't mean to cut you off there. Sorry.
No, no, it's all right. Basically, it gave her some control over fire, and she uses it to mostly like amaze the crowd and like perform for people and even for little children and stuff like that. Yeah.
All right. Great.
So, but right now, her powers, I guess that sacrifice is a bit starting to wane on her powers. So, yeah, she doesn't know how much of a sacrifice she has to make. And as well as she doesn't fully understand her power. So, yeah, that's why she's on this journey.
Okay.
All right. I like it a lot. Now, you have... you'd mentioned at the intro on your character that you had joined up with one of the other players. Which player was that again?
Mm-hmm. Gitmanum.
All right, cool. Excellent. And then taking a look at your look, sorry.
All right.
Double in there. So you've got strange brands that are on your body. How is there one in particular that that you have in mind that you want to describe?
They are mostly on her left arm. And it kind of like, it runs down, it kind of like snakes down towards her wrist. And it's some kind of language that she doesn't fully, she doesn't understand what language it is. And she asked a few people that she trusted, but they don't know they don't understand it as well. But they kind of glow when she's using her powers. Yeah.
Nice. I like that. They also like the idea that you don't quite understand what they are.
Sacrifice.
Mm. Yeah, yeah. No, that's good. That's really good. Let's see here.
As a side note, she still carries the melted pocket watch around her neck.
Oh, nice. I love it. That's really cool. That's awesome. So what made her? Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
So it's like she made the sacrifice of the pocket watch, but then had like a second a doubt to it and decided to save it. If a thing is sacrificed, is usually lost.
Mm-hmm. But she still holds on to it.
Okay, that's actually very interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, it is. I like that a lot. That's great.
Yeah, so she can't use it a second time, but she's still keeping it. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Very cool. Well, is there a particular reason why you would keep it? Is it a connection to your past? Is it a connection to your father? What's one of the main reasons?
Basically, because... yeah, she misses her parents and all that, and she keeps it as a what was that word? Memorabilia.
Yeah.
As a memorabilia of her family. Mm-hmm.
I dig it. That's cool. All right. Very good. Then all right. Well, let's do this. We can talk a little bit about our bonds together, okay. And how they kind of interact and what they do. Right. So, all right. Well, we'll go around the horn again. We'll start with
Jut Merloom.
All right. That difficult.
I'm gonna get it.
So, my first bond is that Ashley's ways are strange and confusing. Since I am from the Pale Stone Cloud, we don't really see a lot of immolators around. And even on my travels around being as a bodyguard and such, it's usually been the normal sort of people. So that when I was overheard this performance troupe talking about the Pale Stone Clan and saw who was talking about it, it's just like, how does she do this? What does she have to do in order to achieve this power and this strength? So I'm a little bit on the reserved side, but I respect the fact that she does have this power, and I know not to test her, if anything.
Interesting. So it's not just that it's confusing, but you also know I'm not testing that. It's not.
No, fire bad. Fire very bad.
Just to kind of dive into that, is that any reason that you would keep a distance with her, or is it just that you respect the power?
Out of respect, yeah.
Okay. All right, cool. If somebody else is going to jump in, please go for it.
No.
All right,
Since Marius isn't here, I'm not going to talk about my bond with him that much, but I just feel like he's always getting into trouble and I have to protect him from himself. So okay. He seems like he's naive to the world still, and he's just like a child in a dwarf's eyes.
Interesting. And then Marius is human and is also a paladin. So, mm-hmm. You know, along with a lot of the fantasy tropes that go along with that, that is kind of built into the character. They have that quest. They have that single-mindedness. So that, that definitely fits in with some of the attitudes and the history that you have as your character. Cool. Mm-hmm.
And the last one is Brynjar. Brynjar is weak-minded and easily persuaded. He must be watched closely. So I do recognize the last name of Oakenshield, so I know the history that he has, and I know his connection to the Thane. So, it's just this one is not now. I'm not keeping. I have to watch him to make sure that he doesn't do anything that betrays both the cause or, like, the respect towards bringing back the Pale Stone Clan to its former glory. Because I don't know what one day he's going to be on our side, and then somebody's going to persuade him to do something else because of this and that, and he's going to be against us.
Interesting. Okay. Now, is there an awareness of his part, however large or small, in your escape? It seems like
No. Like I said, it was in the middle of the night, pushing, just again going up, killing everybody, and then going down, just pushing them out of the way, so I couldn't recognize any faces. But again, when he says the last name of Oakenshield, correct?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Since the Oakenshield family was prominent in the Pale Stone Clan, I do know what his role was in the clan.
Okay. All right. Now I'll switch over to you, Brynjar, real quick here. Are you aware that I would think that the answer is yes, but I want to confirm. You're aware of your part in helping him escape?
Yeah. My thought was that either was he taken to a prison cell, or was he about to be imprisoned?
He was imprisoned, but he was being taken up to his execution.
Okay. Then my thought is he saw Yutman being taken away and either distracted the guards or did not rat out to the Thane about where you were or where you were running. So indirectly, I was allowing you to escape by not being caught in the first place.
Okay.
If that makes sense.
Yeah.
Totally makes sense.
I just have to throw out there, I'm not a native English speaker, so sometimes my mind just stops and blanks out. Just so we know.
Okay.
I like that. Okay. All right. Excellent. Anything else that you wanted to throw in there, Brynjar? Or Jut Merloom?
No, I think that's basically the cover that covers everything about the bonds of the people that we're experiencing with today.
Cool. Right. Well, I already kind of drifted your way, Brynjar, so I'll bring it over to you. So let's talk a little bit about your bonds.
Yeah, my first bond is with Jutmulum, which says, Jutmulum owes me their life, whether they admit it or not. And we basically went over it now. And I indirectly helped him escape, so I don't have to go over that again. Ashley, I have. I worry about the ability of Ashley to survive in a dungeon. As a character, I don't think I've met Ashley and Jutmulum again now before we start. Is that right? Correct?
Well, that's kind of where our discussion will lead after we talk about character creation, is where we start. You know, again, we're dealing with a one-shot, so we don't have a lot of, you know, room to go back and forth. But what that means is that what we can do is start kind of in medias res, in the middle of things, where we are neck deep in the mission or whatever we're supposed to be doing, and that's how we're, you know, how we're going to begin. So I would say let's go with either you know them well or you at least know them because you've been traveling with them for, you know, and we can talk about however long that period is, but you've been traveling with them by now.
Yeah, okay. Going by that, I'd say that Brynjar doesn't really believe in magic. Well, he believes that it's real, but he doesn't trust it because to him, Ashley seems a little bit unstable and not sure how to control her powers, and that's not something he would not take lightly in being in a fight. He doesn't want to die. Not yet, at least.
Not yet. That's always a good thing to hear.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah, who knows? He might jump off a bridge or something. But yeah, he's not sure if Ashley might survive or if she can protect him with her magic, not trusting it. And for Marius, even though he's not here yet, he's a paladin, and his alignment is good, and so his actions are inspiring. Wait, I should read it. Marius' deeds inspire me. As I said, his good deeds and good intentions are inspiring Brynjar because he wants to redeem himself and looks towards Marius for inspiration and how to be a good person and good deeds and all that kind of jazz.
I like it. I like that a lot because especially with your past and where you've come from, you're definitely trying that whole, you know, looking up thing. You're trying to, like, you know, I want to bring myself out of this past and I want my actions to speak more like what Marius' actions speak like so that I can bring honor back to your name and back to the clan. That's excellent. I love that. And I like Ashley's connection as well. The idea that your distrust of magic leads towards a distrust in her ability because of her reliance on that magic. So that's, I mean, if I'm quoting that correctly.
Yeah, you are, of course. Yeah.
Excellent. Interaction with a character and with that and see where it leads. That's really good. Let's see here.
Distrust in magic. I didn't catch that part. So I had to take a call. But why does he not trust magic?
Oh, because he's never been around magic that much, and he doesn't seem that Ashley knows how her magic works.
Okay.
And truly knows how to control it, except sacrificing something and then getting the ability to cast a spell.
Okay.
And in his mind, it's not as stable as using an axe or a sword, which is always there in your hand.
Amen to that.
Yeah.
Very cool. Very cool. And actually, speaking of, or actually speaking of weapons, Brynjar, you'd mentioned that you had an axe, and I think we kind of posted back and forth about, kind of talk very briefly about this. So your weapon, and we'll go back into bonds here in a moment, and I'll come over to you, Ashley. So your axe, did this axe actually belong to your father? Is this the one that was being used?
Yeah, and to his father and his father's father, and it has been passed down for many generations. So for being an old axe, it's still very sharp and strong, being masterly crafted. And Jutmulum, you might even recognize it as the executioner's axe.
Yeah,
when he sees it.
Awesome. I totally love that because it's almost a parallel with your character. You know, your weapon and you are one. and that you're both trying to, you know, you're using this weapon for something better than what it was before. You know, instead of splitting heads or splitting necks, you're out there trying to use this for good. That's really cool. That's really cool. Both of you are stained by blood, all that jazz. I love it. That's just great. Okay, so back into bonds. Let's go over to Ashley. So for your bonds, what have you selected?
Okay, for Brynjar, I will teach Brynjar the true meaning of sacrifice. So I guess Ashley feels like Brynjar has been following the old ways and following rules and such. But she feels that sometimes you need to sacrifice if it means doing the wrong thing. You know, like, sure, it's the law, but if it means punishing someone that is innocent, like, for example, a person steals, but to feed their children, then it, to her eyes, it's not really wrong, but yeah, you should sacrifice, like the old ways, if it feels like the wrong thing or the right thing, yeah.
So kind of bringing our perception of the old ways into the future to, I guess, maybe adapt them? Is that what you're thinking?
Yeah. Is that all right?
No, that's fine. I mean, and I'll throw it over to Brynjar. What do you think about that?
When you say it that way, I understand what you meant. Mm-hmm. So, I like it. It's going to be an interesting conflict and communication between us and how to deal with that.
I think it's interesting too, because it leads. You know, Brynjar is trying to reclaim, you know, an old feeling in his family, the old ways, all of that goes with it, and then Ashley is trying to lead you into a different way of thinking, a new way of thinking. That's really good. So I like that.
Which way is going to win?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Either let go of the past or walk into the future.
Yeah.
New world order.
Yeah. I am the Lord.
Love it.
Okay. And for the second one, I cast something into the fire for Jude Mullum and still owe them their due. I was thinking that she isn't fully aware that she actually made a sacrifice. It kind of makes her, like, I don't know, a bit of an airhead, I don't know. But basically, her sacrifice was that she sacrificed her ties to her troop to join Jude Mullum and seem a debt. Because he's helping her, and yeah.
Okay. So say that first part. There was a little bit of a lag in the internets. So you made an unknown sacrifice for Jude Mullum. I'm gonna get it. It's on me.
The sacrifice you made was basically her ties to her troop, because these guys, they are basically her second family, and like it was a bit hard for her to leave, had to do it, and basically she feels that she needs to help Jude Mullum with this journey.
Nice, I like that. That's really good.
I honestly do personally like that you're not restricting this to, like, physical sacrifices. This is a very interesting take to do with a mechanic that requires a sacrifice.
Yep.
Personally.
I totally agree. That's something that I really think that the system kind of, it helps you think outside of the box.
Mm-hmm.
That's really what Dungeon World strives to do. Yeah. So that's why I enjoy it a lot. Excellent. All right. Thanks a lot. And then you have one there with Marius as well, as the Paladin. Did you want to talk about that, or do you want to save that for later?
I can talk about it now.
Great.
Yeah. Sure. For Marius, Marius has felt the hellish touch of fire, and now they know that my strength. Probably there could have been an argument of sorts. Maybe she argued with the paladin and his ways as well, and the argument got a bit heated, and she actually kind of lost a bit of control. Yeah, and it kind of like blazed out like, and I guess it kind of got burnt. I don't know. Maybe it lost an eyebrow or something.
Maybe
half a beard.
You know, maybe I was honestly, I was personally hoping we'd go along the lines that, like, since he was a paladin and he doesn't know about his past, maybe he had an encounter before he was this all good guy and stuff like that.
Ooh.
So that's why he doesn't know, because he had this encounter with something. So not necessarily like physical fire, but like the personification of a hellish fire. That's what I was hoping I would go along, and you saw that within him. But it's your character, it's your bond. I'm just throwing it out there.
Yeah.
What do you think about that, Ashley?
I think that's a little bit. That's actually better than what I thought of.
Well, that's what it's all about. Is we're combining our brains. Well, that's cool. So it's like you have this kind of fiery presence around you as you're getting emotionally heated, and all of a sudden, there's this wow. Now, do you think that you would have been aware of that, or did you just see something in his eyes that caused him to say, "Okay, I'm gonna back down here for a moment"?
Probably like seeing the conviction in his eyes, I guess.
Nice. I almost, and just to kind of throw it out, I mean, I know he wears armor. He's wearing heavy armor. Let's say I would assume he takes really good care of it, so it's kind of shiny a bit. So maybe like you don't notice it at first. You see it in his eyes, the kind of acquiescence, the release of his stance to you as you're kind of like getting this persona on. But then at the last second, you see that aura in a reflection in his armor, and you're like, "Whoa!" Yeah.
You know, like, kind of like blinded by it.
Yeah.
I like, okay. By light.
I knew it. It's coming. We got the references. Nice work. No, that's really cool.
If only Marius was here.
Yeah, I really want to see his character.
Yeah,
well, he's still working on rebooting and trying to get things going, but if he isn't able to join, we'll get him incorporated as best we can.
All right.
Cool. Well, that's great. So we've kind of gone through the bonds, how we're tied together, and then now we want to talk a little bit about the world around us. I've just kind of given like little hints, little allegations of what's happening, that sort of thing. The way we've kind of, I sent out a little bit of an intro as far as what the world is alike. It was just a couple of paragraphs. I've since added a few notes here and there about certain people, but I want to kind of bring you guys in on how we begin things. So the narrative thread that I put together for this is centered on a clan. And you've heard folks at home, you've heard these guys talk about the Pale Stone Clan. And this is a clan of dwarves that had, at one time, many, many centuries ago, had a high esteem. They had been exceptionally great. Hang on one sec to take one little break. Hang on one sec. Be right back.
Oh, no. We lost
and
the
now
GM.
I'm missing from a sponsor.
Have you been feeling tired lately? Okay. So, yeah. Honestly, though, this is...
Oh, tired is part of my personality.
Chris, take over.
Hey!
Hi.
Yeah, so I'm still really intrigued by kind of the world and kind of seeing that. The bonds are really awesome. Guys, good work on that, kind of getting that fleshed out. that sort of gives a personification of another character that that you kind of help them out sort of with experiences that they've been a part of, and you guys communicating that is really cool. I really like to hear that. Also, too, I think that the going through the character sheets, kind of seeing who people are, some of the things like some of the scars and stuff that you guys have had, and even some of the classes. The Immolator class really intrigues me a lot to kind of, you know, kind of see how that's going to work kind of in-game and stuff. Like how, and I really do, I think it's cool. Like I was first kind of thinking of like physical sacrifice of like, hey, I've saved up a lot of money and I bought this... say this real like precious artifact or something, and then I break it, and then I can cast a spell, kind of a thing. From what I kind of think I understand about the Immolator class, but yeah, the whole emotional break, that type of thing that you don't necessarily think about sometimes. You know, you're kind of like, well, you know, I've got to break my ties with my friends or something like that, or the family that I used to know. You know, some things like that. So that's really cool and gives a lot of in-depth type of thing. So you get to see a very self-sacrificing type person that wants to help people, or maybe he wants to help people but doesn't want to give up something, but he knows he has to help everybody. So that's even cooler. Like that's mm-hmm. like you're not going to find that in another type of a system, I don't mm-hmm. think. No. But it's very, very cool byproduct of all of that. So, but yeah, so I'll hand it back off to Jeff if you're ready.
I am. I had to step out and negotiate things with the dog before he started barking.
Negotiating with the dog, always a priority.
Well, for those at home, I woke up fairly early, and this is something that should be said, that we are around the world here. We are literally around the world, and it's completely awesome. But yeah, it's super early, so I had to let the dog know that don't worry, my wife will be waking up soon, and she'll feed you. Don't worry. the fun of dealing with dogs as children, I guess. All right, great. So let's talk a little bit about the world. And I want to dovetail a little bit on what Chris said. Yeah, the fantastic thing about this system is, again, is that outside-of-the-box thinking that, yeah, sacrifice is one thing and almost kind of leads you back towards, you know, wizards in how they have to buy certain elements or components for their spells to work, that sort of thing. But this is more of like a gut check. Every time Ashley wants to use her magic, there's something that has to go into that ability, great or small. Yeah, it's a part of it. And the thing is that it's also the different perspectives that we have on fighters, on, Brynjar, you're bringing a lot of cool character development already into this, into a fighter that you would normally think is just there to swing an axe and have, you know, cause trouble. But yeah, you're bringing a lot of depth to it. And then, yeah, the barbarian, the expansion on that class and how, it's the focus on the outsider, the reason why. There's a gear towards this kind of emotional and passionate response to things. It's really good. You guys are bringing a lot to the table, and I am extremely humbled about my ability to be able to curtail all of it and keep you people in check, because you guys are going to run amok, and I love it.
Just to quickly say something, though, I think this is like one of the first campaigns I've actually like participated in the development of the world.
Yeah,
because like usually with D&D games, I played Scion, I played Exalted before. It's just you make a character, you show it to the DM takes care of everything else and creates the world. This is like the first time we actually like interact with our fellow players before the game even actually starts. Because usually you build the development within the game once the game already has started. So it's really nice and refreshing to just form something before the actual game even starts.
Yeah, it turns it on its head, and I gotta say, the first time I played this, that was my reaction too. I was just like this seems like backwards. What the heck are we doing? Aren't we gonna develop in game? And I'm like, my DM at the time said, yeah, you are gonna develop in the game, but you're gonna find out why you develop in the game. You know, that's the big deal, is why are you developing? Why are you gearing this way?
That's pretty cool. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun. I hope folks out there will be kind of geared into. Or tapping into this game around their tables. So, okay. So, as far as the world is concerned, so let me jump back into my world notes here, and I'll just read this real briefly. This is kind of what I gave to the folks out there, and then I have a couple of development notes that I'll put onto the side. So, the larger land, that's what I've called this, cities, towns, frontier villages, all fall under the sway of the queen. It's been the way of the world for centuries, leaving only the oldest of dwarf clans and the mercurial and immortal elves to remember what it was like before. But they rarely share that knowledge. Now, all compete for the favor of the queen, the mighty great queen Anariel, the thrice blessed and the light of the world. All live under her and... All live under an unceasing cloud that casts a long gray shadow over the lands, like a constant chill along the spine, with the queen at its center, the only pale light in existence. Now, that's not to say that the sun doesn't exist, that there's not day and night, but it's just this pall that's upon the land. So not all is dank and shrouded. Under this pale light, beauty still shines, and it's not only just with the queen. And that's kind of where we bring your characters into place. Mm-hmm. So your efforts in this is a focus on bringing the Pale Stone clan back to life, bringing them some long dormant glory that's their due, and trying to bring them out from under the wickedness of the recent Thane, whose corruption has led to the ultimate downfall of the clan. And that's the entire mission that you guys are on right now. And that mission focuses on reclaiming something. And I wanted to say that the reclamation is going to come at the loss of the queen. You actually have to take something from her.
Oh. She hates us already, so...
Oh, well, boy. At this point, that's what we can decide. She may not even know of your existence. But you know of the cause that you're following, and you also know of the goal that you need to get to. So that's kind of where I wanted to place things, is that you need to reclaim something, and it is in the queen's possession, whether it's on her lands, whether it's in a home of hers somewhere. Maybe she, you know, who knows, maybe she vacations somewhere in this great land.
She has a beach home over by the pier.
There you go, that's right. this is kind of a chance for us to sculpt the world a little bit. I have some brief notes on a couple of NPCs that I wanted to have involved in some way, and one of them is the queen, and we can talk a little bit about her background. Another one, and I wasn't sure, this is something I'd have to ask Ashley for permission about, is I wanted to develop one of the characters from her circus troupe, or her traveling menagerie. For some reason in my mind, I've taken to calling it Bartleby Swift's Traveling Menagerie. And I wanted to try and figure out what made this so unique, why it had such a following, and then the impact that was on the troop's leader when you left. So, again, just kind of thinking on how that impacts you as a character, and what sort of circus, what sort of menagerie were you involved in? What did they have? What made them famous?
In the beginning, they were just an ordinary traveling circus until Ashley decided to join. Then that's where basically she was the star attraction. She was the flaming maiden, basically, and like they have like skits of her, like either like saving the knight is supposed to save her, but she saves the knight instead, that kind of thing.
Nice.
Crowds and all that, and she's a very people person. So she actually goes in front of crowds and all that. So out of all the other circuses, she actually, for them, they actually interact with the audience. Yeah. So that kind of made them quite famous. And when she left, the leader was quite apprehensive about it because, you know, she's their star attraction, knows that she is losing her ability and people are starting, well, probably like the previous performance, people weren't exactly wowed by her stuff. Mm-hmm. And then he's like, you know, you gotta bring back the spark you have. And she decides to go and leave this find the source of her power, but he needs her to bring back something for him, something of value that attracts. So in case she were to lose her powers again, at least they would have something else to offer the audience, like, oh, this jewel was from the belly of a beast or belly of a dragon or something, you know, that kind of thing. So she has to bring back something, even if she has to might have to steal.
Oh, I was wondering, how did you convince your troop leader to allow you to go? That's awesome. I like that.
That actually might cause some conflict. Oh boy, between the actual players.
Yeah.
In the future.
It might, and the interesting thing, it could create conflict. It could also create potentially endearment, because, you know, Ash, I'm kind of riffing off of this, Ashley, so correct me if I'm wrong. Anytime that I step out of line with anything I say, all you guys have free rein to, like, step in and say, whoa, wait a second. So I'm thinking, when you convince this person, this troop leader, I was thinking of a name like Calabash or something kind of, you know, whimsical, but, you know, looks good on a banner, that sort of thing. But you convince them that you're going to bring something back of value, mm-hmm. whether it's something to add to a performance or it's a mighty jewel with a legendary tale. Now, it could create conflict with the dwarves in the party, just simply because of the direction that they're heading and the reclamation of honor that they're seeking to do for their clan. But it could also be a boon. Go ahead.
No, that was my phone. Don't worry.
Okay. But it could also be a boon, because the honor with which Ashley is trying to pay respect to the troop leader, and knowing how valuable she is to this menagerie, to the circus, she's trying to make sure that she repays that debt of leaving. So that could also be a way to bond you guys even tighter. But again, the method of how she gets this object or whatever it is could come into conflict. So there's kind of an interesting balance that could be there. All right, cool. I love it. So great. So I have a little bit of direction that I can go with on that particular character and some of the things that can kind of spider out from there. You know, because maybe Calabash gets worried, maybe sends somebody along to find out how you're doing, that sort of thing. So there could be potential conflict or assistance in that regard.
Or even force her to come back.
Yeah, saying, okay, you've been gone too long, you need to come back. Mm-hmm. I know you're trying to get something, but you are the something, so you need to come back for this for the circus. So, awesome. That's fantastic. Way to go. Okay, so I have that noted, and talking about the queen, briefly, Queen Anoriel, I don't even know how to pronounce the own names that I created, so don't feel bad. Jut Merloom. I'm going to get it.
I believe.
So for our queen.
Jumanji.
I'm going to get it. You watch. So let me share this real quick with the folks at home. I realize I can go ahead and just share my Evernote here. So hopefully that will show up for folks. All right. So hopefully you guys can kind of see it. If it's a little bit fuzzy, you can kind of walk through it a little bit. One of the things that I threw in there is like her titles. I had a couple of titles there. The Thrice Blessed, Light of the World, and then the Undying Light. So I wanted to kind of give her an aura of mystery, obviously, and then an aura of just this is why she's queen. that feel across the land. So I listed out the three blessings, because she's called the Thrice Blessed. That's her first title. So, and these are subject to change if you guys think there might be something else that you want to add in there that, you know, add something new or a different dimension. So the first blessing is of beauty. So from birth, Anariel was graced with beauty beyond all women in the lands. It was at a young age that a forest dweller, and we don't know who that is or what that entity might represent, took note of her and offered the girl access to the language of the ancients. And in return, Anariel promised to sing songs and tell stories to the denizens of the forest. So it's almost druidic. It could be something else. You never know. So kind of think about that. What do you guys think?
That's interesting. That is very interesting that she has the access to the language of the ancients, which means more likely that she has access to our language in terms of, like, the elves and dwarves and things like that as well.
Yeah. Right.
So Brynjar and me can't just be on the side saying, like, random stuff about her, and she's going to be like, oh, I don't know what to say. What did you do? So we can't get away with that, so that's going to suck.
And I'm thinking these legends will be kind of, you know, known legends. These will be aspects that folks in the land will know. Because so this adds to her... I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, so the stories are translated to all kinds of languages, not just Dwarven or Elvish.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, cool. Anything else that you guys can think of that you might want to throw in there that might add a different dimension to that aspect?
Well, first thing I realized is that this doesn't mean that she's good. If she's beautiful or wise or all that, it doesn't mean that she's a good person or she's a good ruler.
Right.
At least that's my thought.
No, yeah, definitely. They said she would... What was it? Oh, no, click over here. It says that she promised to sing songs and tell stories to the denizens of the forest. So it isn't like mandated to be positive stories, or it could just be stories that she wants them to hear, basically, to convince them that she is this nice and peaceful person. So it's a manipulation tactic, you would say.
Yes. Nice. Okay. I like that. And that's something that maybe you guys have seen across the land. There might be actual tangible examples of this type of manipulation that you're seeing. Would that be a thing that you guys have probably witnessed?
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
Tangible examples, yeah.
Of course, now the internet's seeing how bad a typer I am. all right, cool. Awesome, I love that. Let's see here. This is drifting down. Why is that doing that? I'm also using Microsoft OneNote for... kind of the first time that I'm really getting in depth was using this tool, and it's extremely helpful for all you DMs and players out there. It's exceptionally helpful.
I actually used that last night for a game, and here I can kind of show you what I used it with. Oops, sorry about that.
Ooh. We're entering into a new dimension.
Yeah, so basically I've got this thing like littered full of stuff. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Basically I had one for like Vampire the Requiem. You know, I had a bunch of stuff here with, you know, some pictures and stuff. But specifically I had a... Where did it go? There we go. So... had my my game last night that I had. I had a bunch of some stuff here. I had a GM screen that I sort of copied and pasted so I could go back and refer to for End of the World, for the zombie apocalypse. So I could go back and kind of see some of my notes there. So if I had like tables for difficulties and stuff, and then the ZA, the actual game itself, I had some of the, you know, quick stats here for my players, and then had like a prologue, an intro, and then some and then the actual game itself, just kind of some notes there. So it's real easy to kind of do that. So, but stop presenting. There we go. So, not to interrupt, but definitely something cool that everybody else can use. And also, too, it comes with a screen snippet tool that's really easy to grab and capture things as you're trying to copy and paste them into your actual OneNote itself. So I digress.
Well, that's great. Because, I mean, the other thing, too, is this is the community stream, so we're here not only to entertain but also help the folks in the community for their gaming needs. And last thing on OneNote, you can use it on your phone, and it syncs up across platforms, which is really helpful when you're when you're at a break, quote-unquote, at work, and you're taking a look at some things on your break. On a break. Okay, cool. So we've talked a little bit about some of the aspects of her beauty. So let's talk a little bit about the wisdom, the second blessing that she received. So her time among the ancients brought Anariel great wisdom and clarity of purpose. She saw through their eyes the state of their once great lands, and the name givers had misused their gifts. Now it was time for the ancients to return. Now, judging by what we were talking about a little bit in the first aspect, maybe there's some room for some change here, because maybe she learned her ability of manipulation early on.
Mm-hmm. Who are the name givers, by the way?
That would be, actually, I'm drawing that from Earthdawn. It's any of the sentient races, so it would be humans, elves, dwarves, halflings, whomever.
Okay. And these ancients are now categorized as not one of us or anything like that.
Correct.
They're a super sentient being of any sort.
Some sort, yeah. In fact, if you guys wanted to help define that, we can definitely do that. Or if that's a little bit beyond the one shot, we can move on from there. No worries. I'm having fun with the creation process, so.
I think leaving them as a mystery brings an element of development for the game. So I'd say we leave them out for right now, the ancient part. But it suggests that she does know a lot because of the great wisdom and clarity of purpose. But what purpose would she have? What would be her purpose that she said, oh, now I know my purpose to do this?
Right. Well, is she, you know, it would seem that in her destiny is the rulership of the land, but is it the purpose there to bring the land back under the sway of the ancients or to bring it under her own sway?
Again, she could be just saying that there are these ancients when there really aren't. They could be some sort of story that she could have just made up as well.
Oh. True. I like that. Oh, interesting. Okay. So let's say that folks do believe in the ancients, that there is some kind of other occultish following or whatever, but in order to gain power, the queen may have embellished this to bring her to this level. And some people have doubts. Some people think that maybe she has been manipulating that, but they've not been able to see fit to challenge that. So there's a possibility that, yeah, maybe she is just saying this, and she's using this to take control. That's interesting. I like that. Cool. All right. How about the rest of you? Any thoughts or anything on this particular aspect? Okay.
I'm ready for that.
That's okay. No worries. I know it's kind of late for you out there. All right. Well, let's jump in. If you guys think of something, feel free to jump in. We definitely. Okay. Let's see here. So, touch of the undying. So, time was needed. Her beauty had begun to fade. Her wisdom fell upon the ignorant and the heartless. And for her to succeed, she would need to be heartless, beautiful and heartless, as her enemies. So this is where she's brought on this third aspect, this undying aspect.
So you're saying is she currently immortal at this time? Like she can't die through natural means, but she...
I don't know. You tell me.
What do you guys think? Because if we're facing an immortal, that's going to be like one of the bigger challenges of finding how to kill her, if any, if we have to. If we have
Or if you should. I mean, even if she is
maybe
evil
she's
person,
ageless instead.
Say it again. We didn't catch that.
Like, she can die, ageless. Like she can die, but she can't. She lives a very very long life.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah. So she can be killed by spells and weapons, but not by age.
Yeah, and perhaps the undying part could be like. Maybe a few assassination attempts were made, but they were mostly failed attempts. Like, either it didn't affect her, like, it makes her a little bit more than just human or elf or whatever knowledge she gained from the ancients. Am I right? She access language. Yeah, maybe she learned something from the ancients that made her a little bit more than just mortal.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And so some assassins are like, what the hell? I tried to poison her, but it didn't work. Yeah.
Right. So there are ways to kill her, but maybe there are certain aspects of like these assassination attempts actually.
The direct approach didn't work.
Yeah, certain things might not work.
Okay.
That raises a question.
Some kind of ritual that cut out her heart and like hit her heart somewhere. So we have to find that heart to actually kill her. Something like that. I don't know. Maybe that made her heartless in a literal kind of sense. I'm not sure if vampires do that, but I think there is a mythological creature that actually, you know, removes its own heart and hides it somewhere. To kill it, you actually have to find the heart.
Yeah, that's a lich. That's a lich king. Those are lich kings back in D&D.
I also heard that some Russian legend also hides its heart somewhere. Mm-hmm. It's not possible to find. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Or we could borrow something from the picture of the portrait of Dorian Gray. Have you guys read that before?
Mm-hmm.
Basically, she instilled her soul into a portrait.
Into a portrait. Okay. I like that idea. I actually do like that idea. So instead of actually killing her, we have to kill the portrait.
Yeah. Basically. So the portrait actually shows what she really is like. The portrait ages, the portrait, whenever she diverges in her vices and whatever, it actually reflects in the portrait. So she may look beautiful, but when you see the actual portrait, it looks hideous. It looks like a 500-year-old witch, you know, that kind of thing. So, I don't know, I'm just throwing it out there.
That's cool.
No, that's cool. That's cool. And it is duly noted. Very cool. All right. So anything else that you guys want to throw out there for this?
Yeah, just a question.
Please.
It says a beautiful and heartless, able to outlast her enemies. But who are her enemies then?
That's a good question. So, you know, there's the reason I kind of tackled the queen here is to kind of get a lens into the world. Like, you know, what is the view of this world towards their leadership, towards, you know, towards dwarves, towards elves, or who would be an enemy of this queen if she's considered the only light in a gray land? You know, who would want to oppose this person?
Yeah.
And why? Go for it.
Just a thought. What if she is the person or the force keeping all the darkness around the world and making her the only light, forcing people to ally themselves with them.
Okay. And then would people be aware of this, or is there maybe a select few that becomes aware of this?
Well, at least those who want to assassinate her and bring the light back. And perhaps even the dwarven clan knew this, and it's somehow led to their demise.
Mm-hmm. Maybe we go. Okay. Nice.
People that had a hand in the fall of the clan, actually. Like, maybe someone in the clan actually found out and something about her. Keeping all the light and all that. So, about the fall of this clan.
I mean, we did make a note in, like, the collaboration doc that they were, that this clan was going to be known for their, like, being archivists. So, like, they're withholding information and stuff like that. So, it would be actually play very well that she found out that we know that she does, that what she is. So, leads to scent.
She knows that we know that she knows.
Yes.
Nice. Yeah. So and so okay, so this is interesting now. So do we wanna have your group know the specifics of why they're going for this particular object? And maybe this object is this portrait. It's this picture of Dorian Gray thing that we're going for. Maybe you aren't aware of this the importance of this object. Or are you?
My character wouldn't know it because being an executioner, he wouldn't be able to be in the library of the clan.
Mm-mm. And as a diplomat, I would be mostly on travels, and if I have to stop by a library, I would, as esteemed ranking as I was, I wouldn't go in personally. So I don't think anyone in terms of the dwarves would know it. Maybe the humans. I don't know.
Marius might have known about it, and then. Been brainwashed to forget about it.
Maybe.
Oh, that's right. He does have that memory thing where he's not remembering his past. Good. Okay. All right. And then perhaps this is the corruption of the thing. I put a note in here just real quick. Maybe this is the reason why there was corruption within the leadership of the dwarves, is that the secret was basically the queen and her following was paying them to quote unquote forget or to hide the truth.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Burning a few books or something like that.
All right. Good. All right. Cool. Nice work, everybody. That's just fantastic. So, all right. So we're not quite sure. And actually, you know what? Let me throw that out there. Do you guys want to take a quick break? You know, maybe grab some water, hit the restroom, that sort of thing.
Yeah, sure.
All right, well, let's do that. Why don't we just take a brief, like, 5-minute break, maybe? Or is that enough? Is that okay, Chris? Do that?
Yeah, that sounds cool. So, Jeff, how much longer, like, as far as are we 75% through? Are we 80?
I'd say about 80%, because right now I want to lead into where they are and where we're going to start the adventure.
Very cool. So that's our segue. This is our segue right now. We're kind of breaking, and then we're going to pick up with that and then finish.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, very cool. Yeah, we can definitely
do that. Do you want to stop the recording, or do you...
Yep.
Cool. Right. So let's segue, and let's go ahead and keep going. I'll give it over to you, Jeff.
Awesome. All right, so let's do this. We'll make a turn into how the game is going to start, so when we get back together. Are you guys getting a little feedback on your mic? I don't know if it's mine.
Yeah, I think it sounds like somebody may have their external speakers on, so just make sure you check that. That may can happen.
No, mine is okay.
Not getting anything here.
Mine's okay, too.
No, mine's good. Let me mute mine and see if it's me.
Any feedback?
No, I'm not getting any feedback.
I heard a little bit of an echo.
Try muting yours, Chris. Let me see if that does it.
No, not him. Let me try me.
Yeah, it might be mine. Okay.
Yeah. Hello, any feedback? I did hear it a little bit right there.
Yeah, a little bit.
Let me try muting mine.
Okay. All right, let's see. Hello?
Yeah. Hello, feedback.
No, I don't hear it now. It might be Michael's. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine. We'll just, Michael, if there's any way to maybe pull down your microphone a little bit. I'm not sure. Let's see. I think in your settings you can kind of control it there, but I think just now it started, now so it didn't happen before. So.
What about now?
Let's see. Is there any more feedback?
Barely. Yeah, barely.
It's a little better. I mean, I'm wondering if maybe we can kind of struggle through it. It might be.
Okay. We can push through it. I don't think it'll be too bad, but.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's see. Let's see what we can do. Oh man, I'm totally hearing it. I wonder if maybe I can jump out of the. Let me try jumping out and then jumping back in and see if maybe it might be mine.
Well, so, hey, how about this? Since we're so close to the end, I guess, Michael, if you want to mute yours, and then whenever you want to talk, we'll just you can unmute, and then you'll kind of mute it back, just for temporarily. That's cool.
Okay. All right, that works. Thanks a lot, Michael. Appreciate your help there. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about where we're going to start in the world. I mentioned earlier that we want to try and do something in medias res. I mean, in the middle of things, and that's really ideal for a one-shot game. And I think we have enough of a background, and this is why the background is so important, and the bonds are so important, that we can kind of say that maybe you guys are already in the midst of getting what you want, the object that you need to get, you know, whether it's a picture or a statue or something. Maybe we'll kind of have that as a reveal as the game starts. So here's my thought. Let me check my notes here real quick. So having you guys, whether we want to make this a tried and true dungeon crawl or if we want to make this into something that is a little bit different, you know, I had this feeling this morning or this image this morning when I woke up of like the sound of like glass crashing and somebody flying through it. And like landing on some kind of canopy or something like that below, like two or three stories below, landing safely and then bouncing off of it. I didn't know which character it was. I couldn't picture if it was a dwarf or a human or anything like that. But it could be that maybe you guys are already in the first stages of your mission. You've attempted to try and break into something or to, is it trying to steal something? Are you trying to break into something or is it something else? What do you guys have a feeling for that you would like to see?
I think just right into the action would be really good to see how we react and how we get on our toes. So okay. I think I'm down for that, just being thrusted right into the action.
Okay. All right. I think that's good. All right. What do you think, Brynjar?
No, I agree. I don't really have anything to add to that.
Okay. All right.
Sorry.
And then Ashley, what do you think, Ashley? You think that's something that you could work with? Or do you have a suggestion?
Hold on.
Don't forget
to unmute.
Don't forget you're muted.
I'll unmute him. Boom.
There you go. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right. I actually like being like thrown into battle in the first scenario. That's pretty cool. I like it.
What do you guys think of maybe like a museum or a library setting or something like that? Or, you know, because you guys, it's an object that you're looking for. Maybe you're trying to find research about it, or maybe you're actually on the hunt for the object itself. And I almost want to say that in the middle of this action that you're in the first stage of finding it. You're finding a clue, a breadcrumb that's going to lead you to where you need to be. You're in a museum or in a library or in some person's mansion or house or something like that that you've found this object. And that's gotta also play into some of your characters' traits and backgrounds and your bonds. Is it something that you would actually do, break into a house of some kind, that sort of thing?
Brynjar would be hesitant to do it, but he would be persuaded to do it in the course of the right thing to do.
Okay.
Right. As he's usually used to protecting, like, that's his role as a bodyguard, but he would, as a bodyguard to some lucrative things, I would say. So he would be used to it at this point if he has to do something really stupid.
I like it. All right. And then how about you, Ashley? Is that something that you would feel would play into something that you need? Because it could also kind of line up a little bit with what you're trying to do as a character and maybe get something valuable as well. We can maybe play that up as well as part of your bond.
Yeah, that works. I mean, we could be doing it willingly, or perhaps we have encountered someone that that knows what we're looking for, but we need to do a favor for them, and that favor is to actually break in and grab something for them and bring it back to them.
Yeah. Oh, nice. I like that.
And okay, so maybe the item could be something, a book or an artifact, or even could be a creature, like, I don't know, some rare creature that this guy wants.
Yeah, like a dragon egg or something, or maybe
some
like
a breadcrumb to lead into what we're actually looking for. I think that would be good, definitely.
Say that again.
Like a breadcrumb to lead into the bigger prize.
Right.
It's like maybe like a key or like a page of a book to lead us in the right direction. Something along those lines, I think, would be good.
Okay, so maybe we can merge it together that so let's say that the person that you have come in contact with is because of Jutmerloom. He has maybe a service that he's done in the past, that sort of thing, has connection to an individual. And that individual has knowledge about what they need. You were given some kind of hint of what was required to bring honor back to the clan, and this person has a breadcrumb in that regard. But in return to telling you exactly what that breadcrumb is, let's see here, in return for talking about what that breadcrumb is, you need to get something for him as well. And he's not going to tell you specifically what the breadcrumb is, but he's going to tell you that you need to grab this thing, and that breadcrumb is within this thing, or connects to that thing. So that you're not just saying, oh, well, I'm just going to take the breadcrumb and run and not do this guy the favor. So yeah, okay, so we can kind of merge that together. How's that sound?
That sounds, I think that is really good. Yeah, definitely.
Cool, okay. All right, awesome. What do you think, Brynjar? Are you good with that?
All good. All good.
All right, cool. And then Ashley, how about you? Oh, perfect in both regard. Got it. I see the text message. Nice. All right. Very cool. So, okay. So, they need something in return. They pass. This is a... All right. Cool. And then that will lead us towards what the final mission is going to be in order to get this object. And I think I'll sprinkle in something there for Ashley's character, obviously, that will she'll want to be there as well, may see an opportunity to fulfill something, you know, fulfill that that obligation to Calabash, the circus leader. And yeah, no, that's great. That's great. So fantastic. Then what I'll do is I'll build that first scene. I'll put together kind of a rudimentary map of the place where you guys are going, and then we'll kind of do a theater of the mind as far as positioning goes. There's a phrase that Dungeon World uses called fictional positioning, which is basically saying, you know, the theater of the mind, that, you know, I'm here, this person's there, there's a wall in front of me, I need to go over the wall or around the wall, that sort of thing. And then we just kind of play off of each other on how that works. So great. Any questions or anything that you guys have? Anything that you want to throw out there?
Personally, are we starting off with any money?
Yes. Good question. All right, cool. So I noticed that a couple of you did pick coin. I think it was, I saw Brynjar, you picked the 22 coin,
yeah.
Right? All right, so let's make sure we put that to good use. Let me go to.
Wait, we need to pick the coin. We had a choice of how much coin we can have.
Yeah, you could pick two items, and I took health potions and money.
Ah, I didn't have that option. I only had dungeon rations, a dagger, and a token of where you're traveling and where you're from. So, I don't think I'm destined to have any money. Crap.
Well, here's the thing, though, is that your history is kind of leading me to believe that you might have some. And we talked a little bit on email back and forth about why, you know, yeah, you've come into quite a bit of money because you've been hiring yourself out. You're an employee, and you're good at what you do as a bodyguard, as somebody who's trustworthy as far as, you know, you're trying to spread your reputation as somebody that can be depended upon. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you wouldn't be good at your job. So I would say that there is income. But then when you started hearing about the potential of the clan to regain its honor, to regain its legs, and you have the opportunity to depose this corrupt thane that, you know, basically was responsible for your family's death, was responsible for having you exiled, or forcing you to exile yourself to run away before you were executed, any opportunity to get back at them, you're willing to basically cough up all your coin to try and get into a position to be successful.
Yeah, definitely.
And along that road, you met Ashley, you've met these others who are also of like mind, and we can talk about that meeting as the game unfolds and maybe have like little brief flashbacks of like, oh, I remember seeing you for the first time, Ashley, when we were at the menagerie. I was out of money, and I had one coin left, and I thought, you know, I'm going to see this traveling menagerie and then offer mm-hmm. myself as a bodyguard to travel further or something like that. Okay, cool. So let's talk a little bit about coin. If you guys have access to the book, there is like equipment that would be available to purchase. And I think that is on page 324, that's where the weapons list starts. And for those folks playing at home, something to consider, and I'll go ahead and I'll share my screen briefly here just to so you guys can see. Let's see here. All right, you guys got that? Yay! All right, so here's where the rules kind of play in ever so briefly with buying weapons, that sort of thing. And I'll say that for each of your characters, you're going to have, let's see here. I want to say, just to kind of be fair, I want to say 10 coin to spend. To be able to pick up something, whether it's armor or weapons, that's beyond what you already have with your character starting pool. I think, Ashley, that would be fair of something that Calabash, the circus leader, would probably give you some coin to do your mission because you've successfully convinced them that, yeah, if you did need to go somewhere or if they wanted another attraction, because maybe Calabash thinks that he's going to keep you anyway, but then he's going to have another attraction in the circus. So he's going to give you a little bit of an investment to say, okay, go out there and find what's needed. So on page 324, the weapons start, and something to pay attention to are what's called tags. Tags are like what some of these weapons will do or what can be used. Like, for instance, looking at the different bows that are there, the ragged bows, so something that's not quite great, is only effective at a near range, whereas a fine bow or a hunter's bow is effective at near and far. The other comments that are there, you have how much it costs or however many coin it costs, and that's just kind of a general descriptor of money in this world. And then you have the weight. You want to consider on your character sheet what your max load is, and then, you know, work into how that's going to affect what you get. For those who are going to be getting arrows or bundles of arrows, that sort of thing, you'll see that they have there's a 3 ammo, 4 ammo, so on and so forth. Now, ammo in Dungeon World doesn't effectively mean that you only have 3 arrows. It just means that your uses of these arrows are limited to a certain quantifiable amount. So let's say you're shooting arrows at an incoming enemy, and they've got a stone wall behind them. And you roll your dice, and you roll a 6 or less. Mm-hmm. Well, what happens is that maybe you miss this character, and your arrow hits the stone wall, and you lose it. It obliterates. And so maybe your ammo count goes from 3 to 2. But if, let's say, you get a 7 to 9 or a 10 or plus, I would say that as a GM, I would tell you that you can recover that arrow. Or maybe you send out 10 arrows and you get a success rate of 7 to 9. You maybe can recover 7 out of the 10 arrows. So it kind of leads, the ammo count is more of a negotiating factor depending upon how well you roll in the game. Does that make sense? Any questions on that?
No, that makes sense.
Cool. All right, so you have, there's armor that's available as well. Some of them have different tags that can cause good or bad effects, such as clumsy, that can cause a little bit of a difficulty when it comes to maneuvering, unless you have some specialty of availability for using armor. I think Brynjar, your character, has a quality that allows them to use armor a little more effectively.
Yeah.
So there you go. So as far as tags, that sort of thing that we would have applied to a weapon, let's take a look at one of my favorites is messy. So you have a weapon that has a messy tag. It does damage in a particularly destructive way, ripping people and things apart. Now, that's not so much to enhance damage, which in fact it could as part of the fiction, but what it means is it gives you the opportunity to kind of describe a lot more of what's happening. Like, instead of it just being a thin slice of a weapon, it's a ragged sword. It's got a rough edge with nicks and imperfections, and it causes a shredding of the person's body, or it shreds up the armor or whatever you're attacking. So it's an opportunity to kind of really shine with your own description of what happens. But it's also, in reverse, a way for me to describe something that might happen. Let's say you have that messy weapon, but you get a 6 or less on your roll. So you roll your 2d6, you add your modifier, and you get a 6 or less. All of a sudden, that messy weapon turns into a potential path of destruction to the people around you. You know, maybe you were standing right next to one of your comrades, and you swing that weapon, and you miss horribly, and there's a possibility that you might hit somebody next to you. So, something to kind of keep in mind for your tags and what you can do to enhance the description that you put out there. So any questions on those?
Particularly me, I do...
You go ahead, John.
Oh, I think...
I had the mess. Am I muted?
No, you're on. You're on.
Okay. I had the messy and forceful tags on me. How would that affect, like, you saying that the storyline would be affected, you have, like, the ability if I do mess up horribly, how bad would that be? I forget what the forceful did.
Well, that's forceful does, let's see, do I still have it out there? Yeah. So forceful, it can knock someone back a pace, maybe even off their feet. So, you know, you make an impressive swing, and not only are you damaging this person, and you'll be able to roll some form of damage based on your character, but you'll also potentially knock them back. Like, let's say you're fighting somebody and they're on the edge of a cliff, and you give them a good whack, and it's not only did you split open their guts, but you also send them over the cliff, and that's pretty much it. You get your Wilhelm scream, and then you're done. So that's how forceful can work. Now, as far as what it could be as a detriment, you know, maybe you swing so wide that maybe you don't damage the person next to you, but the force of your swing causes them to duck. And then that imposes a negative on their next roll because they have to, like, avoid that mighty weapon lest they lose their head. So and this is kind of the give and take with Dungeon World, which is interesting, that when you don't succeed, so, like, you know, we'll run the mechanics very briefly. You roll 2d6, you have your associated modifiers, you know, given your attribute or whatever weapon you might be using or ability. And a 10 plus, you get the thing that you want. You get to describe it as colorfully as you want, and I give the floor to you when it comes to success. A 7 to a 9 means that basically you're going to get the thing that you want, but there is going to be some form of consequence. There's either, you know, maybe you chip your weapon, or, you know, it might be something not that severe, but something happens. Maybe you're thrown off balance and you open yourself up to an attack, that sort of thing. And then a 6 or less means that I control the floor. You miss, you open yourself up to an attack, but there may be something else that happens. Like I said, somebody has a negative to their next roll because you were in that vicinity. If it's a social interaction, it causes a negative. Well, maybe this person suddenly really doesn't like you and wants to try to have you arrested. So all sorts of things can happen and unfold in the narrative. And we'll have fun with it. It's not going to necessarily only be the GM making the moves when those negative things happen. It can also be kind of a discussion with us as to what we want to do. So, long explanation. I hope that fit. That was okay. All right, cool. All right, any other questions that you guys have?
Yeah, I have two tags which I'm wondering about. Just from Sharp, which says plus two piercing. What does piercing do?
All right, so piercing, it goes right through the armor. So when you deal damage with a piercing weapon, you subtract the end from the enemy's armor for that attack. So whatever that number is that you have next to that precise tag, that's what you subtract for the enemy's armor. So whenever you damage somebody, your armor rating is going to subtract from that damage. So this is going to say, oh, you know what? I get through that chink in the armor because maybe it's a spike on the axe. You flip it around in your hand and you're able to use the spike, or maybe it has a long crescent, you know, aspect to it that, you know, you have some form of piercing in there. Or it just could be a really sharp edge. And we'll just make it simple.
Yeah.
Did that help?
Yeah, it did.
That worked? Okay, and then anything, what else did you have?
Yeah, precise.
Precise. So precise, it rewards careful strikes. So that you can use dex to hack and slash versus using strength. You have that option. It's almost like weapon finesse in D&D or Pathfinder.
Yeah.
So if your dex bonus is better, you can definitely use that. If your strength bonus is better, you can use that instead.
Oh, okay. Yeah. My strength is better than my dexterity, so... But having
so, you know, if that's the case, I mean, is that something that maybe you might want to, you know, want to change as part of the description on the weapons or the aspect of the weapon?
Because character-wise, it makes sense to be both sharp and precise, and not being optimal, but I think about it.
Okay, yeah, and definitely, I mean, you know, take a look at it. You know, the other part I was thinking maybe it might be, because it's a headsman's axe, you want to do it in one swing. What if it is huge? What if it's messy and forceful, but also sharp and piercing, because you want to make an impact with that weapon? You want to make a statement. So, just food for thought. You don't have to choose that. If you want to choose something else, go for it. It's totally
that'd be a scary weapon, to be honest with you. A precise, messy, forceful axe. That's a scary weapon to deal with.
It's just definitely. I just had everything on it with duct tape.
Everything.
It also got
so stained with blood. The weapon is as stained as my soul.
Oh, that's sad.
Well, this is good. This is really good. Cool. All right. Any other questions that you guys have? Haven't heard anything from you, Ashley. What do you have?
I have a question about my burning brand.
Okay.
It says that I will have a tag, a weapon will have the tag fiery and dangerous. What does dangerous mean? I mean, other than the obvious. How would
don't get in front of this weapon.
Like, from a mechanical standpoint, how does it play?
Sure. Well, fiery is obviously going to add some fire damage. It's going to add some aspect to that, and maybe through the narrative or through the fiction, we can maybe add in, like, you know, you start setting the person's cloak on fire, or maybe you miss a swing, and your weapon that you conjure or that you use, you know, causes something else to burst, and, you know, hopefully not Brynjar or something. What was the other one? It was
Dangerous.
There we go. Okay, let's see here. Actually, you know what? I don't have it listed right in front of me, so my apologies. I'm going to use the magics of Google to look that up and verify what that is. So, let's see. Dangerous. I'm going to be surprised about what kind of things that I'll get when I'm dangerous, but we'll just say some dangerous dungeon world. I've learned never hurt, but I feel lucky.
You just realize that this weapon is dangerous. I should never use it.
I should not be using this. This thing is awful.
I have another question as well. For my starting moves, stuff like Burning Brand, I have to make a sacrifice for that as well?
Correct, yes. So, okay, so let's take a look at that on your character.
Weapon to stand by in case I have nothing to sacrifice.
There's always something to sacrifice, and that's the creative part of it. That's and in this being part of your starting moves, it's not going to need to be something huge. You know, it depends on the intensity of what you want to have happen. So if you're really trying to impose your will and you're wanting to use Burning Brand as a huge statement, you know, as big a statement as Brynjar's Headsman's Axe, then maybe you might have to sacrifice a little bit more. And the more you sacrifice as the GM, I might say, you know what, take a +2 to your roll because you're really giving something up to make this happen. So we can kind of work with that a little bit. So it could be something as simple as saying, you know, maybe you have to pull some hair out or something, or you need to toss in an item of clothing or one of your personal belongings, that sort of thing. It doesn't necessarily have to be a huge token that's completely bonded to you, but the more you want to do, the more that object needs to be close to your heart, as it were. That makes sense?
That would be quite funny. I'm like, all right, hang on, guys, I got this.
I can just imagine that one of the sacrifices is going to be like her hand or something like that, and it's going to just be like, oh god, why'd you do that, why?
Well, then, and that's when you look over and you see that the dragon that was about to attack you has now burst into flames or something. So you're like, oh, that's it, that's why. Okay, I got it.
What?
Oh, good cause. I'm bleeding.
Yeah, you never know.
You always sacrifice a dignity.
Yeah, sacrifice a dignity. That's true. That's a good point. That's a good point.
Do a very silly dance.
You must do a silly dance for this to work. I love it. Okay, so I found the dangerous quality here. It's easy to get in trouble with it. If you interact with it without proper precautions, the GM may freely invoke the consequences of your foolish actions. So it's because of that secondary property of fire, or I probably should call it the primary property of fire that's on your weapon when you do that Burning Brand, that you need to be cautious with it. So when you ignite this weapon, I may ask you, okay, well, how are you using this? What are you doing? And if you're like swinging it wildly like a banshee or something like that, I may say, okay, the room around you is starting to burst into flames. So yeah, something to kind of be careful with when you're using the weapon. Okay, cool. All right, any other questions?
Right. I think I'm good with it.
Am I able to purchase a weapon now, or we have to come across a merchant in town?
No, go for it now. You've got your 10 coin. Brynjar, I'm going to leave you with your 22 so that you can work with that if that's okay. And then you're going to get your plus 10 as well, so you'll have 32 to work with. So because you made that option to sacrifice a gear or something to get that 22 gold, I'm not gonna penalize you because I'm handing 10 gold or 10 coin out to everybody. So just wanted to leave that there.
Okay.
All right. Well, great, guys. Aside from the technical difficulties of getting everything together, I think it's turned out to be a really awesome session. I'm seeing Marcus attempting to jump in and jump out, and I really am bummed that he wasn't able to be here, but we'll work with him this week, so it'll be on all of our shoulders to make sure that he's getting included with a lot of the decisions that we made. Chris, if it's okay to make this recording at first, maybe available just to us here so that we can maybe draw some notes from that if we need to throughout the week. That always helps me as a GM to be able to go back and listen, that sort of thing, and I'm sure the rest of the folks here might want to do that too, if possible.
Yeah, most definitely. We can do that. Do you have anything else?
That actually, I was going to say, if there's no other questions, I'm pretty much done.
Okay.
That's what I wanted to accomplish this session. And under normal circumstances, we would just flow into the game at this point. I think with our schedules and making sure that we get things started off right and then balancing the technology, get this out of the way now.
Yeah, no, this is a very, very good time since everybody is so new to the system. We sort of had like a sort of a primer or session zero type thing to Vampire the Requiem, but we only really kind of did like maybe one roll, and it's not the same kind of when it's in-game, so you're trying to figure out the system while you're playing it. So this way it's very very interesting, at least not as far as game mechanics go, but as far as the world and creating. And you guys seem like y'all are going to be very a lot more tighter knit together. So that sounds really cool. So big thanks to our GM, Jeff. We appreciate that. Thank you to all the PCs. You guys have been working so hard on your characters, working diligently and stuff for this, and that I really appreciate that, and everybody really appreciates that, because it's really going to show very well and show up in the inside the game and make it more alive itself. And a big thanks again to the Invictus, all those guys there. We really appreciate them for that. And that's all I have. I don't really have anything else. Just, you know, if you're tuning in to this during the week or whenever we post it, make sure that you're following on Wednesdays and come on for the main Invictus stream. And then also come check us out on Facebook, too, at the community. And that's kind of where all this culmination has started from. So come check us out there to just chat and stuff like that. So without further ado, as Oscar always likes to say,
we'll see you on the table, I guess.
There you have it. So everybody have a great one. We'll see y'all later.
All right. Cool.